Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I'm Howard. You're hearing Olivia as well. We're going to push on because now we are mainly back to work. We understand that you've taken some very valuable time out of your day to come to this and listen to us. So we're going to get on with this now and make sure that if you have any questions, you put them in the question box and we can answer them. But we'll also allow time for questions at the end as well. So we're going to move on now. And if we could have the next slide, please, Olivia, if you will. So we're talking about what legislation is relevant to driver and rider trainers and what these new policies and procedures have been based on. And what we're looking at is what happened at the lockdown, the shielding and protection of family, communication with sort of track and trace as well, and cleanliness aspects, and social distancing as well, which obviously we need to go through too, and also MTV and testing, which is the minimum test vehicle standards for the DVSA. So we'll have a chat about all those and what's come out of it. We had a few webinars last week. We had Chris Benstead, who was talking from the point of view of a large driving school. The week before, we had Mark Jaffe from Croydon, who actually owns the largest motorcycle training company in the country. And he, both those two webinars gave some good insights of how organizations have been dealing and trying to get the positives out of a bad situation, really. We always have to make the best we can of a bad situation. And we've heard today that the booking portal for general public is now open. Might be struggling a little bit probably with the onslaught of tests that are likely to be taking place today when trying to get the tests that have been waiting in the wings. So no doubt the DVSA may have a couple of problems with that, but I'm afraid if they do, we'll just have to ride the storm with that as well. So first thing we'll go on to, we can go on to the next slide now, then, please, Olivia, if you will. And we're talking about the lockdown. What actually happened? Well, the decision to lock down actually wasn't taken very lightly from what we understand. We've got had a situation where it was the government decision was taken about a week or so, probably 10 days before lockdown actually took place, as an option that they had, whether to do it regional or whether to do it as the four nations together. They could have done it with just England and left Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland to do their own thing. But eventually they chose to do the full lockdown with the whole of the four nations together, with the devolved nations playing their part in making decisions as well. Give me 1 second, because I've got a bit of a problem here. Here we go. Right, okay. So everything was decided really from an act that took place in 1984. And that was for England only, which is the Public Health Control Diseases Act 1984. This came up really because we thought that the control of diseases may possibly have come from a nuclear war, believe it or not. Sorry, I know it sounds a bit daft, but if you can remember the 80s when Frankie Goes to Hollywood came out with all their songs and that about a nuclear war, etc. Well, it got people thinking, to be honest with you. There's a music industry actually got the country thinking. And so the Control of Diseases Act was brought out in 84 to lock down, if need be, for any event. They call it control of diseases, but it was for anything else as well. So because it was for England only, it couldn't be used by the government to lock down the whole country. So what had to happen was there had to be a policy passed by the government as soon as they could do it. And they had to set up a complete new policy for this through all four, England and the three devolved nations. So it became a national regulation, and the Coronavirus Act 2020, which was signed off by Her Majesty on the 14th of March 2020, was the act which everything came under. Now, the thing is, this act is normally an act, is a statute that takes sometimes years to get through, because the Public Health Control of Disease 1984 was already written. All that had to be done to that was amendments. But to make it credible, they had to turn it into an emergency act, an emergency statute, which was signed off by Her Majesty. But that emergency statute is many regulations put together. So its amendment to the Act for Devolved Regions has produced regulations for all to use in the independent parts of the UK, and it created the Coronavirus Regulations 2020. And that's what we've worked with, is Coronavirus Regulations 2020, which in itself is just one of the regulations of the Coronavirus Act. So there's loads and loads of amendments that we're all dealing with as to why we clean our cars, why we perhaps we're wearing masks in certain parts of industry and commerce, how industry and commerce have been advised to change their ways in order to reduce spread. So it's come from all of these different regulations from different parts of industry that have all been formed together to form the Coronavirus Regulations. So the Coronavirus Regulations 2020 is not one sole regulation. It's a whole, library or encyclopedia of many regulations all put together, which the government delves into to try to advise different areas of industry and commerce, because they can't write regulations for every single one. And that's the reason why we didn't get anything written for the driver training industry. We came under transport, which actually, although Department for Transport, you'd think would run it, we came under the business sector of legislation. And I can't remember what the department is, business and industry, I think it's called, is what we came under. So most of our legislation for us to have gone back to work and for us to be social distance, etc., has come through the business sector rather than Department for Transport. And this is why the DVSA have been unable to give the answers as quickly as they wanted to, because they weren't just dealing with the Department for Transport and the ministers for transport. They were dealing with the ministers for business as well, because everything has to align to the whole country, has to line up, all ducks have to be in a row. So it makes, although we all call it a bit of a mockery at the moment, it would be even more of a mockery if the business sector wasn't consulted on what we had to do, because we came under business and industry as well as Department for Transport. So it makes things very, very difficult for anybody to make any decisions, because although the DVSA is supposed to be our monitoring body, they're only an executive agency, which means that they can run, but they can't necessarily have autonomy. Autonomy has to come from above them. So they were looking from two different departments to get their autonomy from. And that's why things have taken so long. Now, we didn't realize this at the time, because no one really understood the workings of the government. But that's really, in essence, what has come out of this. And this is why we still haven't got all four devolved nations working at the same rate. Scotland have gone back to doing lessons. I think it's Monday, isn't it, Olivia? 24th, isn't it?
Lessons are resuming on the 24th.
Yeah. That's right. And then testing on, we think, on the 14th of September, we think.
Yeah.
So they are a bit behind us. So if we look now at the next slide, please, if we can. So with the Coronavirus Regulations, they've been amended and increased by individual pieces of legislation, the main one being Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions Regulations 2020. Now, you can see England in brackets there. There is actually separate ones for Scotland, for Northern Ireland, and for Wales. And the number three is just the amendment that's been done since March. So the England regulations for health protection has been updated three times. And if you go into the gov.uk website and find this, it'll actually give you the dates of the updates. So each nation has its own regulations, and that's why we've got different return dates for Wales, Scotland, and Northern Ireland. But the reason for this is because we are getting local lockdowns in England. I mean, Oldham, I believe, looks like it's going to be under the cosh now. There was talk of it this morning on the news and last night on the news. Birmingham as well, possibly, by the look of it as well, because the R number is spiking. The amount of, the ratio of infectors is rising above what they would like to have. So if it's sort of gone from 7 to 7 infections to 100,000 that the country can just about live with. But when it goes to 14, 15, 16 infections to 100,000, it's quite feasible for one person, not just to infect one person, but by the time you've chucked a stone in the pond and watched the ripples and seen all the people come into contact with each other, and it takes 2 weeks for 10 days, 2 weeks for everything to incubate, you've got a massive problem down the road. So as soon as they see the R number rise just slightly, but rise at a higher rate than it did before, that's when the alarm bells start ringing. And that's when the health protection coronavirus restrictions, England, Scotland, Northern Ireland, Wales, all kicks in. Now, Scotland, we're due to start back earlier. We had this in England with the health and beauty industry, which were due to start 2 weeks before, and the 48 hours before they were due to start, the government said, sorry, our number's not where it should be. It's not where we thought it would have gone down for this, for you to start, but we can't because you're in too close proximity. You're almost touching distance. Therefore, we've got to put you back down for another 2 weeks. Now, Scotland's been doing that because the R number started rising in Dundee, in Aberdeen and Elgin, around the top north part of the country where there's not a lot of population. But because there's a small amount of population, the ratios look bigger and they've got to protect themselves from it. So Scotland's been a bit later. I'm not exactly sure what's happening in Wales at the moment. I think they're still a little bit behind. But Northern Ireland have been quite proactive and their website is very, very good for information. The NI Direct website has been incredibly good and they keep it up to date very quickly indeed. So Northern Ireland seem to be a bit more on the pulse of what's going on. But bearing in mind for our industry over in Northern Ireland, we've got a register of 39, 40,000 driving instructors plus. The Northern Ireland have got a register of only 1,100 because they've only got 5% of the population living there. So they've got a much smaller register. The DVA is a much smaller entity compared to the DVSA, much smaller. So if we could move on to the next slide, what have we got to do? Well, we have got to shield and protect our families. And the problem we've got is our own training vehicles could become a reservoir of bad activity if we're not careful. And that is why we had to go through the cleaning regimes, which I'll talk about in just a moment. But what we have got here, the link in front of you. Now, remember, this webinar is recorded. So if you go into it later as recording, you can make notes of all these links that we've got down here. But the Digital NHS UK, this particular link will go into two other links, which I think we show on the next slide, actually. And they are for the people, which is extremely vulnerable persons from COVID-19 and those who expect to get unwell or most likely to be unwell. There's guidance for both types of people. So what we have to do with our assessments of who we put in the car, for example, can have an adverse risk on the protection of our own households, because we can deep clean the car and get it as clean as we reasonably can and do what we call reasonably practicable to get it as clean as we can. But the thing we have with it is that unless we keep touching up with the antibacterial wipes, etc., after we've changed drivers and whenever we go into a demonstration drive, we need to try and boost that deep clean as much as we can throughout the whole week. I mean, if it takes a long time to do a deep clean on the vehicle, and it takes your time, it's your time when you can't be training. So, I mean, you need to do it a minimum of once a week, and depending on what sort of training you're doing, that's whether you need to do it more often than that, depending on the vulnerability of the people you've got in the car. So if you're doing people with special needs, for example, or the more elderly, you categorize the elderly population for training, then perhaps you might need to clean the car down a deep clean more often than once a week. It really does depend. So with our vehicle, if we're not careful, we'll become a reservoir for a den of iniquity if we're not careful. And so we have to make sure that we do risk assessments as best we can on the people that are going to get in there. So that is why when we were doing the toolkit for people coming back to work after COVID, we found the information from the NHS Health, which is the, which one are we talking about? The Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions, found, went back into that and found a document which was, I can't remember the title of it, but it was cleanliness of establishments not in a healthcare setting, which is what we came under. And unbeknown to us, we picked up on it, but so did the RAC. And it turned out that both the DIA, we shared it with NASP, and the RAC both sourced out the same information, to be honest, and both came to the same conclusion, independently of each other, that deep cleans of vehicles were required. And so the information we put up there actually was pretty much endorsed by the RAC Foundation, and that's a very big organisation. And that's not small fry. So for us to come up with that and they sort of do the same thing means we've endorsed each other effectively, meaning we're both thinking along the same lines and we really can't have gone too far wrong. So when we were coming back to work, we said to you, you need to phone the students when you came back because you hadn't seen them for a while, but you still need to get, even though you get a phone call saying, can you teach me to drive? And you book them 2 weeks ahead in the diary, you would still need to phone that student 24 hours before to ensure you know what's happened to him within the 2 weeks since you last spoke to him. So we're making sure this reservoir cannot, your vehicle cannot be used as a reservoir for the germs that you don't want in there. So you're going to be finding out the things, or should be finding out the things about where these people been. Are they shielding people in a vulnerable state, which are what these two slide, these two links are here, which will tell them, you know, you can always guide them to these links and say that that's where you need to go to. And they're all found on the gov.uk website. If you go into that and then go into the search and put in a few keywords, these things tend to come up quite quickly. The gov.uk website for this is very good and very informative. It really is. A lot of reading, but, you know, the information is there. So when you're trying to get the information from the students, your proposed students, potential students, you need to, you can then tell them about how the whole place is going to be set up. And you can then also discuss things with parents if they're at that age where parents need to know what's going on, about how the vehicle is going to be kept clean and the protocols that you are needing to put in place now in order to reduce the risk and keep things clean to a reasonably practicable state that you can do. Now, you've got to appreciate that you're going to have other people in the vehicle as well, not just that one student. And therefore, all we can do is keep the vehicle reasonably, practicably clean. But it does involve us doing a deep clean at least once a week with the information we've got in the COVID toolkit, and also to clean the vehicle down after every driver. And I would suggest as well that when you get out of the vehicle to do your briefing, say you do an hour and a half lesson, that you stop every 25, 30 minutes to have a chat outside the vehicle if weather permits, or you can find a place where you can do that, with the windows down if the weather allows you. Obviously nothing on show that can be stolen, etc., and the car locks as such, but at least the vehicle kept secure as possible, to let the vehicle vent. And then when you get back in, wipe it all down again so you can keep it all topped up, basically. So we're trying to find out, letting the students know exactly how we're going to be leading the session. You obviously go through the syllabus that they're going to do if they're brand new to driving, and just keep them at ease is what we should be doing all the time. It does take your time. It is a lot of effort on your part. Now it is a new regime we have to get to, and I suppose really a system will click into place as far as you're concerned, because you'll start doing this all the time and you'll find it a lot easier to settle the students down as time goes on. And later on, you can tell them what the testing regime is. That's like to change bit by bit as the COVID R number comes down and the test centres can be utilised more than what they currently can. So again, the system will change there and we'll start getting back to the old ways. But to be honest, that's not likely to be very soon. So we can go on to the next slide, if you will, please. And what we're talking about here now is you ask yourself, first of all, have you got any symptoms? The first place you've got to start with every single day is how well do you feel? And if you the symptoms take some time if it's COVID to come on board. But if you are going to be teaching someone who's over 50, and they're saying that now is the age where vulnerability starts kicking in, if you're going to be teaching someone who's not a youngster and you have a cold, you've got streaming eyes, whatever, even though that may not be coronavirus related, you may have to consider as to whether you actually do any lessons that day. Now, the problem is now we've got is although normally we'd fight on and get through the day, we've got to sit back and consider if our vulnerabilities could be the opening to the virus. Because if we're going to start blowing noses and wiping eyes from our own surfaces of our own vehicle, other people have touched, then we are actually opening ourselves up to an extra form of risk. Whereas normally you wouldn't worry about it, I'm afraid now we've got to start considering it. I'm not saying don't work, but you must make an informed choice for yourself as to what risk you are. Because if you are shielding people in your own house, then you've then increased the reservoir in your own vehicle. And that's what we've got to consider is that reservoir. So
Any,
what to do if you've got, sorry, go on.
I was just going to say, order a test and trace kit, and isolate for a couple of days just to be on the safe side. We talked about the practicalities of doing this. It's not easy for a self-employed people where you're relying on that income. But like we've said, and Carly said on previous webinars, it's about doing your best. I'm sure a lot of you are, because why wouldn't you to lock in those funds, try and get pupils to pay in advance, things like that. And so you've got that sort of income there. But not to divert onto that too much, but looking at the health implications that Howard's talking about is to maybe, as he says, normally we'd push on, and we would we have a really strong work ethic. We have to because we're self-employed and all the rest of it. But we do have to have that additional, hang on a minute, you have to check yourself for a moment and think, right, is this anything that I don't like look of? Do I think I'm going to pose a risk to myself or other people? And so coming into that cold season, it's going to be more challenging. It's going to be more difficult. So trying to just determine or differentiate between COVID symptoms, which apparently people have said, with the smell and the taste, which have been reported on the news recently, that they are very different. It's not like you've got a stuffed up nose and you're finding it hard to taste or smell. It is almost like a complete loss without the stuffed up nose. So, there are some subtle changes, but as we've seen throughout all this whole pandemic, things will vary from person to person in how these symptoms are presenting themselves. Some people have reported stomach upsets from it, and that's also been they've been tested positive. So it's whether it is a COVID symptom that's just unique to a few people or what. It's so hard to try and round up whether this is COVID or not. So if you are in any doubt, then you need to think about, as Howard said, locking yourself away maybe, or for a bit, until some test results come back. I know one or two of you, I'm trying to message you on here, just one or two of you said you're having trouble seeing the slides. And for some reason I can't message you. It's not playing nicely today. Just so you know, we are recording it. It will be available soon. So you will be able to go on there and see those. The other thing you could do is try logging out and back in again. Maybe that could help. Even try a different browser. So sorry, guys. I know there's a couple of you that have messaged to say you can't see. So I have gone back with that reply, but I don't think it's got through to you. So for some reason, it's not let me send, which is a little bit frustrating. But you could try those things, or if you're just happy to listen along, then they will be available later.
Okay, so what I shall be talking at now is going back really to I'll say interview with a person you've got after not seeing them for a long time, because some people haven't gone back yet, believe it or not. There's only about 70% of instructors are actually back on the road in England. Not everyone's gone back because they're shielding, or there's other reasons they don't think they're ready to go back, or they're on a long they've done emergency services for many years on a big pension, so why take the risk type thing. There's reasons why people haven't gone back. So what we need to consider now, it's come up as well, is this blasted travel corridor that's seems to be bouncing up and down, a lot of turbulence at the moment. So here you've got the travel corridor advice for all the four nations of the UK. They're all different, and there's different rules for the four devolved nations. So the information there is for you to look at your in any time you want to, but you must consider how well you are in order for your vehicle not to become a reservoir, which is one of the medical terminologies for there's reservoirs and there's canals and there's all sorts of things that they're using as terminology of how the COVID spreads, which we actually had in a previous webinar that Carly did. A lot of research was done in that, and Carly explained that very well with some very, very good diagrams. And now that webinar is in the Academy, I believe, at diaacademy.co.uk. All the former webinars that we've done since about March or February are in there. So you can go back and look at any of those anytime you want to. They're all recorded. But the one that Carly did on PPE and how coronavirus has spread was a particularly good webinar. It's a lot of information in there, and all about the, there's a lot of health information stuff in there, similar to what I'm saying now, which is quite useful for you to know. So we're going to make sure we are safe, because once people get into your vehicle, that nice clean vehicle you've deep cleaned, that is when it goes downhill from there, because as soon as the first person gets in there, you've got contamination. So you've got to look at their background, see what they're doing. If they have got no issues of shielding, they're fit, they're young, they're healthy, they are not sort of burning the candle at both ends, they're not mixing when they shouldn't do, then, and you're the same situation, you're the same health balance, and there's obviously a lot less risk there for the reservoir of the car, because what goes into that vehicle from your side of the family, your family, could be transmitted to the student that gets out the other side and goes into their household. So it's like a conduit. That's the problem we have. There might be a reservoir and pool, but it's also a conduit that can spread things to other people. So this deep clean must be done by the ADI, not a valeting company. Because when you see the valeting companies do it, they get four or five people crawl all over your car. That's four or five different households you know absolutely nothing about that have got in your car. And although they've cleaned your car, they've left their mark in there as well.
It'd be more than four or five households if you think about it, because that's what they're doing all day, isn't it?
Well, that's true, yeah, yeah. Multiply it by 20 cars they do a day, yeah. So the situation you have is also to take consideration that if you are able to limit anybody else driving that car, if it's a business car, try to limit for business as much as you possibly can, because then if your partner or your children that can drive the same car, then they are also getting into that reservoir, and they can then bring that back into the house. There's now two of you in the house, so your risk in your house could possibly have doubled. So is these sort of things what we have to think? We have to think along these lines now. We can't do it any other way. Now, if you go, again, I'm talking about the coronavirus toolkit. If you're a member of the DIA, you can get into the coronavirus toolkit in the members area of driving.org. You need your password to get into driving.org. I can't remember how you get into that bit of the toolkit. Is there a toolkit password? Is there, Olivia? I can't remember. Is there?
Just log into the DIA members area and you'll see it.
I see. Oh, okay. It's not a password to get into the toolkit.
It's not.
Oh, good. Okay. Right. Okay. So you get into the members area. If you're a member of the DIA and you've got your password, if you can't remember your password, then if you want to email help@driving.org, and then we can get that sent out to you, so you can get in there and get into the toolkit. And in the toolkit, there's a paper-based template of all of the clean down regime for your vehicle. The daily checks as well, and also a risk analysis of who you might meet and what the situation is on how it can affect the reservoir of your vehicle. So it looks at all of the risk takings, red, amber, and green, of the person who you're like to be teaching. You then weigh it up against the situation your household is in, and you make an informed choice from that as to whether you're going to train that person or not. What you have to remember now is you may not be able to train every single person that rings you for lessons, because you've got to consider what risk they will be to your household. So if you are shielding people who are infirm, who are at the critical needs, people shielding, there's two of them. I forgot what they are. One's critical needs, and the other one is, I forgot what the other's called, Lydia. Can you remember what it is? There's critical needs and there's another one. And one's slightly lower than the other, but they both have to be protected. So you've got to make sure, if you're in those categories, that the person who would like to train with you, is it possible that they could infect the reservoir that you're going to get out of at the end of the day and walk back into your house and cause a possible risk to the people who you are shielding? And I'm sorry to really sort of carp on about this, but I'm afraid this is the mindset we now have to have for some considerable time. And I've been talking, my brother works for a statistics place for banks, and all this information is what they have for footfall, because the health industry have realized that places like banks, where people can congregate in a big room, although they're letting a few in at a time, but you go to a desk and you do your dealings at the desk. There's no time to wipe the desks down in between times, and therefore they are now being regarded as a reservoir of COVID. So again, it's a situation where it's not just your car, and they are a bigger setting where there's much more air and space there. So places where people are going to commune, even to do dealings on a one-to-one, can still be a problem. So we have got to have this mindset now of how can we be affected by somebody else that we're going to come into contact with. We are still a little bit at sea with intensive courses. People doing starting at the beginning of the week and trying to take a test at the end of the week. The chief medical officer, Chris Whitty, has said right from the off that if people have to be in a vehicle two to a time, like lorry drivers do when they're doing stuff like Argos deliveries, where it's furniture being delivered, then the two people at the same, the team should be the same team through the whole week. Okay, that's fair enough. But they've got a bigger distance in the cabs of those vehicles, so that makes it slightly different. They're also able to get out and wash their hands at probably every call. Everywhere they go to, they can ask to wash their hands or whatever, if need be, because they can't just leave the stuff out on the driveway. They've got to take it into the house. So they can sanitize before they go in, and they can wash their hands again when they come out. You as driving instructors don't get that option. It's not, some of the public toilets are not open yet. They haven't opened them up. But the ones where I live around here, near Clacton where I live, the ones in my little town, there's three sets here and only one set is open, and they're only open for half a day. So, you know, you trying to get facilities that you need is they're getting quite short, it's quite few and far between. So we have to try, this is why we've got to wipe down the vehicles and have the antibacterial wipes and the hand gel and everything else at hand all the time to try and keep us as clean as we can.
Just coming back to that question, sorry, Howard, was you were talking about the two different types as high risk and sort of moderate risk. So high risk, so people who may have had an organ transplant or some sort of cancer treatment, such as immunotherapy, chemotherapy, you know, those kind of things, maybe a condition high risk of getting infections such as sickle cell. And also then you've got moderate risk, so people who are 70 or older, pregnant, have maybe had asthma or emphysema or something like that, maybe a heart condition, diabetes. So those types of conditions. So they were the two that I think you're referring to.
Okay, thank you. No, thanks for looking up. I just couldn't, it just didn't come to my mind.
Oh, it's yeah, there's a lot going on, and I knew it, but a few examples of each one. So I just had to have a little look on the NASP guidelines, people, for the National Association Strategic Partnership website. If you type that into Google, National Association Strategic Partnership, that's DIA, MSA, and NJC, collectively we're known as NASP. So have a little look on there. There's lots of guidance and things that have been recently updated. I've just moved a slide on for you there, Howard.
Yeah, great, because this is what we were talking about a second ago, is ask yourself. So if you look at this, I don't know how well you can see that there, but if you, this is just an excerpt of the thing I was saying, it's in the COVID toolkit, which can be downloaded. It's for you to use. So here's one example that for the trainer, if the trainer lives with a partner that is a senior nurse on a COVID-19 ward, neither are in the enhanced at-risk health sector. Okay, the client, if your client is a healthcare worker working with non-COVID-19 patients, but in a GP surgery hospital or care home, that client would have been a critical worker, but that's all been stopped. That all stops for Monday. But risk rating, both households pose the same risk to each other, so there'll be a medium risk. So the reactions by the client and pupil, the client would need to ensure that they have washed their hands just prior to entering your vehicle and should wear protective gloves. A face covering should be considered. Long trousers and long sleeves should be worn, and no open footwear. Now, in the throes when we were in a lockdown and people were doing key worker stuff, long sleeves and long trousers was the thing of the day. The Chris Whitty, again, the chief medical officer, said, well, short sleeves aren't so bad, providing you've got facilities to be able to sanitize that part of the skin. So they are sanitized before they get into the vehicle. And even during, if you stop to have a chat with someone, they can do it again during the chat and get themselves sanitized again where the skin is bare. So they're not touching things like armrests on your door, etc. Although you're going to wipe them down, the minimum contact as possible. We then move on to the next one for risk to trainer. It's a moderate risk post the ADI, because your partner is a nurse on a COVID-19 ward and the client is in a healthcare setting in a non-COVID environment. But we've heard the stories from the nursing homes where they said that everything was COVID safe, and there's been a lot of adverse publicity afterwards to say that they weren't quite so COVID averse as everyone thought they were. So it's a moderate risk post the ADI. So response by the trainer is, the trainer must ensure that overexposure to the client does not take place. Intensive lessons are not recommended due to the lack of social distancing, because we're now at 1 meter plus. That means the plus, but it means we must take all possible due diligence to help not to protect each other, which means possibly gloves and masks. It isn't a legal requirement, to be honest, to wear masks when training. It's, you know, there's regulations saying you ought to, but it's not a legal requirement to say you've got to. But ideally, I mean, obviously, the sane judgment and common sense says you ought to. If you are wearing masks, even though you are wearing masks, it is, again, Chris Whitty, the chief medical officer, said, face the front. Do not turn to your student to converse with them. If you need to have a conversation with them, then put them on the side of the road, get out of the vehicle, and talk face to face at the appropriate safe distance. With us, it's 1 meter plus, but if you're outside, you can afford 2 meters, and why risk at 1 meter plus when you can have 2 or 3 meters? So really and truly, masks should be available. On the test, they've got to be worn. The DVSA and the MTV regulations saying that masks must be worn by student and examiner unless there's a medical reason why they can't be worn. And that has to be disclosed at the time of booking for the student. So we move on to the next, to the next column.
Ah.
The last column.
Okay.
We've got the additional guidance for trainer. Contact any client prior to meeting to discuss their health. The vehicle must be sanitized. Social distancing must be observed outside the vehicle. Handshakes and the sharing of pens, iPads, and training aids is not allowed. Do not face each other when speaking. Keep vehicle ventilated. Do not use air conditioning or vents on recycled air mode. Okay, so if it's pouring out of rain, again, Chris Whitty has said, look, the problem with aircon is not as bad as they thought, but it mustn't go on recycled air. It must be air coming in from outside, and only use the aircon as sparingly as you possibly can, because we know it's not fuel efficient, but fresh air is better than air coming through an aircon. That's what they've, King's College Hospital did some research on this. I haven't seen the results, but I've heard that the results are why Chris Whitty has come out with that statement. Okay. If you, by the way, want to get more information on what goes on with the research, there is an app in the App Store, and it's not the NHS one. It's called, literally called C19. It's COVID-19. And I can't remember the name of the company that actually produces it, but I've actually got it on my phone, and it's done by King's College Hospital and an organization called Zoe. Zoe funds it. And I can tell you now, I've been on this since before the lockdown, and I was very ill. I say very ill. I was reasonably quite ill back February, March time when this all kicked off. And at that time, there were 11 known symptoms for COVID, and I had 8 of them. And I was really quite poorly. And I signed on to this. And the information about losing your sense of smell and the red welts, raised skin rash on the feet and ankles and legs was all known to King's College Hospital about 4 weeks before it was ever spoken about on the news. So if you ever want to be ahead of what's going on, C19 app is actually King's College Hospital's app, and it's a research app. So you're putting in there your state of health, how well you feel, and it takes literally seconds to fill in every day. And what they do once a week is they come back with a little survey of how much have you been out of the household, wearing or not wearing a mask, blah, blah, blah. And they collate all this information. And I think they've got 4.1 million people following them on this at the moment. And they're getting a lot of information from this. And from this app, they are collating information, which is then becoming what's happening on the news, something like 2 or 3 weeks later, but you hear it first. So you want to be in that situation when you're dealing with students. You really do, because you've got to keep everything reasonably practically clean. So you need to know what's coming.
I was going to say, Howard, on the App Store for like Apple, I've got an Apple phone. Apologies, I haven't got the Google Play access at the moment. But C19, there are two. There's one which is a green one by Every Life Technologies. And that one seems to be for information from updated C19 symptom checks to include, and the UK's chief medical officers. So is it that one? It's like a green.
Yeah, let me find. I'm just going into the App Store now. I've got it open now, and it's called the COVID symptom study, and it's a C with a hyphen 19 in a sort of dark coloured box. That's the one you're looking for.
Ooh.
And it has got King's College on it as well. King's College Research, it says on it.
So it wasn't right.
When I did it, it was underneath the NHS one in the App Store. So the NHS was the first one, and this one was the second one. And it's I can't find on here. All days with King's College London and shared with the NHS. But it's just literally a light blue and dark blue seal with a patch of red on it, -19, and that's its logo. And that's the one that's in the App Store. If you can get that, it's King's College and Zoe. That's the one you want. That seems to be more ahead than the Oxford University stuff that's going on. Okay, so if we can move on to the next slide, if we can. So cleanliness and sanitation, regular deep cleans of the vehicles, because we need to reduce our vehicle from being a reservoir if we possibly can. And obviously sanitize between the drives. And this link here is the cleaning of non-healthcare settings outside the home, updated, I think it was on the 19th, which was this week. So it is updated really often. And this is where we got the information from about the deep clean. If you read it through, it doesn't say deep clean your vehicle, blah, 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 but you can read between the lines, because it's not just dealing with driving instructors, it's dealing with any organization is a non-healthcare setting. So it's dealing with banks and shops and offices and those places of keeping them clean. And we're reading between lines and saying, they're saying use the bleach-free disinfectant, blah, blah, blah. And we're saying exactly the same thing. And they're saying dose it down very, very regularly and then top it up with cleaning like we're doing with wipes. So all we're doing is we have taken all that information and use that for the vehicles to keep them as clean as possible. Now, I'm going to be a very serious note here now. It is absolutely imperative that when you do these cleans, you write down when you have done them, the date. Now, I don't want to get all legal here, but we don't want a situation where you get the fright of your life when one of your pupils phones up and says, I think you've given me COVID-19. Now, let's just cut that to the chase straight away. For anyone to prove that they've been infected from a driving school car, they've got to prove it beyond reasonable doubt because they have a life. They probably get on a bus or go on the underground. They go to the bank. They go to McDonald's. They go out and have a drink at the pub and have a meal because they get £10 off because the government's let them do it. They're mixing with other people. So just because they're doing driving lessons with you and they get the symptoms, they could have picked it up from anywhere, even from a supermarket trolley, even from a fuel pump on a petrol station. They could have picked it from anywhere. So they've got to prove beyond reasonable doubt. But what can help the reasonable doubt against them is by you having the paper chase. So you've got it written down. Now, all this is in the toolkit. So you need, if you're a member of the DIA, that's at your disposal, download it and use it. Because then you can mark down the daily, when you've done the deep clean, you can mark down all your daily checks you've done on your vehicle as well, and you can sign them off. You can use them as marketing, so you can take them to prospective clients and say, this is what I do with my vehicle. Here's my track record of what I've done. And then if anyone comes to you and they try and accuse you of, well, I caught COVID from your vehicle, well, you can go to the court and say, Your Honor, here's a track record, and it goes back for all this time. And they're going to look at you and think, right, this guy has done everything that is reasonably practicable. They must have caught it from somewhere else. Now, I've had one guy on the phone who hasn't had an accusation from him, but the guy, one of his students had to stop training because he went down with symptoms and he sort of intoned, I think I might have got it from your car. Luckily, the ADI took our notice from us at a webinar he heard, which is the one I spoke about that Carly did, and he did write everything down and he did take it to solicitor and said, look, that's what I've done. And solicitor wrote a letter to the guy's solicitor and said, don't miss a bloody wet. There's no way on this earth has this guy not taken the precautions that he's needed to take. And he sent the evidence over, whole thing was dropped. So you need to be in this litigious world we've got where anyone's going to try and make a buck out of you and you're all working really hard, you know, you do need to protect yourself. So not only are you protecting yourself from one household to another and stopping your vehicle becoming a reservoir, you really need to make sure that you have a track record of what you're doing. Now, again, I am going to get legal now. Every single company, including sole traders who work for himself, is supposed to have a health and safety policy. For a company that doesn't employ, who employs five people or less, that doesn't have to be written down. But for five people or more, it's got to be written down and available for inspection. So you guys who have got franchises, okay, those guys do not come into your office, but you are acting as an agent for them. So therefore, you have to have a health and safety policy written down. You who are sole traders who work from your own homes don't have to have it written down. But if you are asked what your health and safety policy is, you should be able to recite it. So by saving these bits of paper with the dates of when you've cleaned your vehicle is certainly going to help that cause. And you really, really do need to be doing it. I can't stress it enough. Okay, so that's that. They are frightened to death now. You're never going to listen to me again. So we're now come to pretty much to the end of this, I think, aren't we, Olivia?
Yeah, almost.
Yeah. Have we got any questions in the question box? Anybody got any questions? Because I'm not seeing anything there at the moment, unless we've got a problem, they're not coming through.
Yeah.
Okay, go on. What have we got?
Where can I find a health and safety, I think that's policy to print out. So, as Howard says there, if you go into log into the DIA, health and safety policy, apologies, because you've mentioned the policy.
I'll tell you where you get that. If you go to the Health and Safety Executive website, they have a template for it. on the HSE website. I think it's just literally, you may have to get to the Gov.UK website to get to, or you might just go into www.hse.gov.uk, and I think that might take you in there as well. But I remember looking in there last week, and I remember stumbling across a template, and I'm pretty sure it was a health and safety template, and exactly, and a very good explanation of what a risk assessment and everything is. The risk assessment, as we call it in the toolkit, is basically the simplified form that I showed you of who you're going to meet, weigh up what your household is like and the household you're going to come up against, and work out what you're going to do. And we've got, I think there's about 21 different scenarios. That's just one snippet you saw. There's about 21 different scenarios that we've got on that downloadable form that you can look at. So that acts as a template for risk assessment in many respects. But if you literally want to write down everything for health and safety template, health and safety risk assessment policy, then the HSE is the place to go. And they're very helpful. If you need to contact them, don't think they're all bureaucratic and stuffy nose. They're not. They are really incredibly helpful people, and they'll bend over backwards to help you because they want you to get it right. They don't want to come in your place and inspect. They want to make sure, you know, if you can do it for yourself, then they can leave you alone. You know, that's what they want to do. And that's their attitude to it. It's good. So HSC is the one you want.
Yeah, I've just sent a reply to you, Philip, about that. And I've sent you a link to HSE, the website, so about how to create a policy. And if you Google, you know, creating a health and safety policy, there are free ones you can download as well from companies such as Rocket Lawyer and things like that on there. So free templates you can use as a basis and fill in according to your business. But as Howard says, yeah, the HSE one, it does start about, it gives you a template to follow. So policy statement, part one, statement of intent, and it will, you have to put in there about, you know, what you do, and your health and safety policy is to, and you can just do bullet points, you know, prevent cases of work-related, you know, or transmission of COVID, do this, do that. So you, and then sign it and date that. Part two, responsibilities for health and safety, day-to-day responsibility for insurance policies put into practice. So, you know, there's lots of things on there. So I've shared the link. Hopefully everyone can see it. But it's hsc.gov.uk, and it's /simple-health-safety/policy/index. So but I have put the link on there, so hopefully you'll be able to see that, guys.
Did you reply that by email to Philip, is what he's asked, because it's not showing on the screen here?
I'm having trouble with this today. It's I did do right. I've clicked post to reply to everyone, to post that reply, and it's not doing it. Like, I've tried to reply to a few people.
Yeah, it's not showing up on there at all, is it? There's no answers on there at all.
It's having a day today. So yeah. I'm just trying to think. Oh, I'll tell you what I'll do. Hold on. What I will do, let me see if I can screen share that particular tab, because right, bear with.
But while you're doing that, Olivia, Pat's got a question. I can
you'll see that stopped at the moment, so just hold on a sec.
Okay.
And there, so hopefully you can see, those of you that can see the screen, I've now shared a different one of my tabs with you. So if you look at the top, you've got hsc.gov.uk/simple-health-safety.
It's not there, Olivia. It's because we've got our ribbons, or it's hidden behind the ribbons of our screen. So it needs, can you bring it down a bit?
Cookies.
Come in lower than that.
How many cookies? No, because that's the bar at the top. Oh,
okay. All right.
Oh, goodness. Howard, what I'm going to do, right, I'm going to mess with
you. Hang on a minute. What you've done is you've mentioned it in there, and it's on recording, isn't it?
It is.
Yeah. So we've got it in recording for you there, Phil. I'm afraid that's at the moment. Unless you can email into us at, what is it? what is it, support@driving.org, are we?
Support@driving.org.
Yeah, if you email in support@driving.org, anybody who wants that link will email it back to you. Okay, support@driving.org comes to me and Olivia. So if you want, anybody wants that link for HSC, we'll send it out to you. Okay, we'll send it by return. We'll get you this afternoon. Okay, we've got a question from Pat. Pat has said, that they haven't had a test post-lockdown. Have the examiners got any extra COVID-type requirements in terms of test car condition for prepping by you? Yes, now the DVSA have sent this out, Pat, on what they call their direct mails, and they've been sending them out two or three of these, actually. So if you haven't received these from the DVSA, they may have gone to your spam folder, but they are sending them out nearly every week. So
the other thing you could do, Pat, is going on the NASP website, and the updated guidance is on there about lessons and tests. So if you type into Google National Association Strategic Partnership, NASP, then that's on there for you as well.
Yeah, there are things that you need to know about for a test, but it's best that you read it all through, because what NASP has got has come directly from DVSA. So you're almost getting it from the horse's mouth. So it's better you get it directly from, see it on the screen, really. Okay. All right. So have we got any more questions? I'm just looking in the chats now. So anything in the chats that we can answer? If you go into the chat, Sean has actually found that link and put it in the chats for us. Thank you, Sean. That's great that you've done that. Thank you. That's a great help to us.
Brilliant. Well done.
All right. So that's good. Yeah, Julie, you haven't been able to see the slides. Yes, this has been recorded, and it will take, this recording probably won't be up before Monday, because Matt's not with us today. He's on holiday. So I think this will be up probably Monday afternoon in the Academy, DIA Academy, and you should be able to see all of that and hear it all again. Let's have a look, anything else?
Hold on. I know the screen's gone blank, guys. I'm just I'm trying something else. Hold on. I'm determined to get this link up. So I'm trying something else. Bear with. Right. Okay. So let's go back to there.
So Olivia always talks to herself.
There you go. Look.
Only time she gets the correct answers.
Ha ha ha. So how's that then? Has everyone seen a link appear? Can you see it, Howard?
Yeah, I can see. Yeah, if you just mention the chats, if you can see the link on the screen, please. Yeah, everyone's seeing it. That's good.
Okay. All right, I'll leave it up for a moment. Just as we're going to start to wind the session up in a moment. The slides will be available on the recording for those of you who want to watch it back. And for those of you who had trouble with seeing the slides, I'm not sure. Sometimes it might be a bit of a try a different browser if you come and join us again. That could be something to try, because I don't think there's any particular browser that, you know, should work with all, but you know, that could be something that you might want to have a little look at as well. Okay, so hopefully everyone's jotted that link down, because what I'll do now is I'll move on to the roundup slides now. So that's the email, excuse me, that Howard mentioned. That's where you can find Howard and myself for help and advice, supportdriving.org, so we can help you with a few things to help the running of your day-to-day business. We've had I wouldn't even like to guess how many calls and emails we've had, Howard, over the last few months. It's been it's been the time, but it's hopefully we've been able to help you with those. So that's where we are if you need that.
Find the app I was talking about. It is COVID Symptom Study, and it is by I'm just trying to move over. It's by Zoe Global Limited. That's so good. And it's a purpley, I'm colourblind, sorry, but it's a very dark coloured box, looks purpley, with a different colour blue. It's got sort of mauve and red, and as a C with a dash 19 in it all. So that's the one. It's underneath the NHS ones in the App Store.
Yeah.
And that's the one that's been done by King's College, and the research there goes, is shared with NHS, but the research comes out on the app earlier, and you'll get to know everything that they found about 2 weeks before it gets on the news. So you're going to be ahead of what's going on.
Okay, cool. Okay, so there are some short courses for those of you, as Hal said, on the DIA Academy, which is a different website to the driving.org for the membership and the toolkit. So Academy is where we put all the training courses and all the recorded webinars and things like that. So there is a big load of stuff there. There are a couple of free courses that you could try. And we are adding a new one shortly, which will be one about equality and diversity. Plus, also, we've got our level 3 accredited safeguarding course. Now, there is also a £15 off offer on that currently. So if you haven't, I know it's, you might think, well, you know, it's not my priority right now, but it needs to be, because it's one of the fundamentals that, you know, should be part of what we do. And it's, you know, you recognizing signs and symptoms and what to do and how to report, when to report, if to report, what to, you know, all of those sorts of questions. If you think, I don't know, I'm not too happy with this situation. Could be a pupil, could be someone, could even be a neighbor. It could be someone else like that. So it's, as I say, it's online. Normally we deliver it in the classroom, but unable to at the moment. Online, and you've got 3 weeks to complete the course, usually delivered in a day. So, you know, you can then guess from that that it's not massively onerous on your time and resource there. And we will be having some group Zoom sessions throughout as well. So you will be able to have a chat with us, and we'll be able to talk about it in from an ADI or rider training context as well. So that's really well worth doing. And also, you know, since the lockdown, there's been a massive spike in domestic abuse cases and things like that. So, you know, you may well be able to help somebody if you see something on this, you know, learn more about it. You might recognise some signs and symptoms. It doesn't always mean to say that you've got to jump into action straight away, but it's some, you know, this course will show you kind of what to do next and how, that type of thing. So £15 off that at the moment, so well worth
Sarah's,
it.
Sarah is with us, said she signed up for it already, and she's looking forward to it.
Yeah, okay, fantastic. So we do need some more bums on seats on that. So if and we do have some bookings, but we would like to see a few more. You know, be great little community. And this will be the first one we've run, so that'd be really, you know, exciting to deliver the course online. And for you, it's a lot of it's self-guided learning. So, you know, we give you the resources, you go away, you have a little read, you have a little learn, you think about it, and then we meet up a couple of times a week on a Zoom session with a tutor as a group. So it'd be good. It'd be a really good thing to do, and you know, well worth it for you guys as well. So I think that's about it at the moment. So we're gonna wrap up and sign off now, guys. So thank you for your time. Thank you for your questions. Is that all the questions being done now, I think?
Yeah, I can't see any more here. And I've looked through the chats. There's nothing outstanding in the chats. It's really...
So we're good to wrap up. So
yeah.
So Howard and I will be signing off now, guys and girls. So thank you so much for your time today. And thank you, Howard, for sharing all of that information. We understand some of it was going over some old ground, but that's a good thing, just to make sure that you are making sure that you're up to date, you're current, everything you're doing, you're clarifying it for your own peace of mind as well. Also, you know, Howard's pointed you in towards the app for C19, so you've got some more information there to go on. And also a bit of background about, you know, where all this legislation comes from and where it, you know, because we do get those questions quite frequently. So thank you, Howard, for that as well.
That's okay. Everyone batten down the hatches, because I'm on the East Coast here and we're getting battered really hard here. I know we've got people over in Colchester, but I'm right on the coast of the east end of Essex. And I tell you now, the wind is a lot higher than what they said it's going to be today. I've got a Christmas tree was planted in my garden. It was put there in 1961 when the first owners built this thing, and the thing is noticeably bending. So I'm getting a bit worried. It is really quite strong wind. So batten yourselves down, look after yourselves, and if you need any information from us, you know we are. Livia and I are at support@driving.org for ADI questions. Okay. Have a good weekend. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Ben. Bye.